July the 8th, 1939, and the Duchess of Kent comes to open Birmingham's new airport.
I have just had the pleasure of inspecting this magnificent new airport, and I would like to congratulate you and all those concerned in the building of it on your enterprise and foresight. I now have much pleasure in declaring the airport of Birmingham open and in wishing it and on all those associated with it every success.
But few commercial flights were to use Elmden for the next 10 years. 2 months after the opening, the RAF were its new tenants and the city was at war. Just 14 years after Birmingham's Hall of Memory had been opened to commemorate the 13,000 dead and 35,000 disabled from the war to end all wars, Britain was once more pitted against the might of Germany. The task of breaking the news to the nation fell to Neville Chamberlain, a son of the young city which his family and friends had spent 70 years guiding through a period of growth, prosperity, and enviable local government.
This morning, the British ambassador in Berlin handed the German government a final note stating that unless we heard from them by 11 o'clock, that they were prepared at once to withdraw their troops from Poland, a state of war would exist between us. I have to tell you now that no such undertaking has been received, and that consequently, this country is at war with Germany.
Rehearsals for evacuation had taken place during July and August. The sight of thousands of children and their teachers gathering at mainline stations on their way to unknown destinations, most of them to stay with total strangers, is the enduring image of that autumn of 1939.
We mustered at Anglesey Street School during the summer holidays, because it was during the summer holidays that the war broke out. And there was about 200 of us in the playground, all in various groups, I don't know why, and we were issued with a gas mask in a cardboard case with a string around our neck and our name and address tied on a label which was tied to our lapel. And off we marched to Hockley Station.
I was evacuated for exactly 2 days. I didn't go with the school because I'd got an auntie who lived at Kidderminster, and I was taken. I thought it better if I went there than to strangers. But I stayed exactly 2 nights, lay in bed listening to the planes going over, got worried to death about my mother being bombed, and cried all night. So they were glad to bring me back home.
I asked Mum why we were going on the train. She said because a nasty man named Hitler's going to come, and he's got eyes as big as saucers and he eats up little girls. There was a little boy there, he was younger than me, he was clutching a seaside bucket and spade. He thought he was going to the seaside. When I saw him about 3 days later in Leamington, he'd still got the bucket and spade and he was looking for the donkeys.
Evacuation brought in its wake general mobilisation and the call-up of reservists.
There wasn't the same rush to arms in 1939 that there'd been in 1914. There wasn't the same measure of enthusiasm. It was this feeling, well, we've done all we can to avoid war and it's come upon us, and we've got to make the best of a bad job.
There were dire predictions that air attacks would kill between 50,000 and 100,000 people using poison gas. Air raid precautions focused on the gas mask.
When you talked about ARP, as it was known in those days, the first thing came to mind was a gas mask, as it was commonly called, the respirator. And of course, the government had provided respirators from the very young to the very old. The baby helmet, small child respirator, the civilian respirator, even respirators for invalids, respirators for horses, respirators for dogs. And so, you know, when you did think about the war, you started to think about the possibility of gas attack.
Rearmament had begun as early as 1936 with the government's shadow factory scheme. Negotiations were opened with the big motor car manufacturers to use their massive potential to bring Britain's aircraft production up to parity with that of Germany. In Birmingham, Rover factories at Acocks Green and Solihull produced the Bristol Hercules aero engine. The government built the two factories, equipped them, and in some cases even recruited the staff, but after that left the day-to-day running in the hands of the Rover management. Not surprisingly, the aero factories were to become major Luftwaffe targets, but then, although shadowy, they weren't exactly secret.
It would have been in 1938 when we had a delegation from production people from Germany and also high-ranking members of the Luftwaffe to look round. I think the government had done it quite deliberately with the idea of showing the Germans that we were either prepared or getting prepared. It obviously didn't work very well.
It was the threat of invasion in the months after Dunkirk that prompted the War Secretary Anthony Eden to appeal for able-bodied men between the ages of 17 and 65 to form a local defence volunteer force. In Birmingham, the response was overwhelming. More than 30,000 volunteered straight away. Eventually, the city's Home Guard, as Churchill was to call them, numbered more than 50,000.
Hear those marching feet down our village street. It's the Home Guard going on parade. Every mother's son shouldering a gun out to show the stuff on which we're made. We're all set to win. Now I'll tell you all about the mob that I am in. When the lads of the village get cracking down the road to victory.
Approximately one night a week, we gave up our time to come and guard and patrol the factory. The block behind me, which is the moulding block 6, we had an observation post on top of there, right on the very top, and it was part of our duty to spend a couple of hours on the OP. In front of us was a table with a huge compass, and we plotted the direction of the bombs and the flames, etc. That gave us some idea of the amount of pressure that was being put on the city.
I don't recall that any bullets were fired in anger as far as the Bourneville Home Guard were concerned, but things might have happened accidentally, and it was a mortar type of weapon which we used, which was fired off accidentally and demolished one of the chimneys across on the far side of the road.
It was a big step from Easter eggs to hand grenades. Cadbury's chocolate factory joined the war effort with Bourneville Utilities, making aeroplane parts, respirators and army water bottles. Car factories switched their peacetime production to tanks and armoured cars. Jewellers used their skills for radar and aeroplane equipment. Lucas factories turned out gun turrets, while Dunlop kept the wheels turning. Morale was boosted by royal visits, especially to the munitions factories, where women workers were setting records for shell production. With over 400,000 people engaged in war production, it was inevitable that Birmingham drew the attention of the Luftwaffe. The first enemy air raid happened shortly after 1 o'clock on the morning of the 9th of August, 1940, when a single enemy bomber, probably looking for Fort Dunlop or the aero factory at Castle Bromwich, dropped its bombs on Erdington, killing an off-duty soldier at number 23 Montague Road and injuring six other people.
I suppose we were all in bed. I used to be about, 2 to 3 o'clock in the morning. And suddenly the silence was shattered with Mum shouting out, "Oh, Harry, they are all around us, you know." And the melee broke. We jumped out of bed, you know. And I can recall Mum being on the landing, like, you know, looking through the landing window. And I can recall the flashes of the... as the bombs burst, like, you know. And, of course, we ran downstairs. We really didn't know what to do. You know, we'd had no drill or anything like that. And then a bit later on, as I say, there was a frantic knocking at the front door. And Dad opened the front door, and there was my sister, who lived on the opposite side of the Bromford Lane. She'd run across the Bromford Lane just in a nightie. And, Mum, she'd run back to Mum, left her husband in bed.
Air raid shelters, the Anderson that could be erected inside or outside the house, the under-table steel cage Morrison, were the basic means of civilian protection. But they had their drawbacks, and the Anderson shelter, in its usual place at the bottom of the garden, was uncomfortable, cold, and often inches deep in water.
The baby being born in August, we had a very severe winter in 1940, and I would have lost him anyway if I'd have taken him up into the shelter. So I used to just stand by his cot in the bedroom, look out of the window, and see where the fires were starting. I used to think, well, it's there or there. We're all right tonight. And I used to stand by, ready to grab him if necessary and run up the garden to the shelter. But you see, in the cold, severe weather, going from a warm cot right out into a shelter at the top of the garden, right down in the earth, very cold, I would have probably lost him anyway.
The scale of wartime armament production in Birmingham was colossal. Over 11,500 Spitfires and 300 Lancasters at Castle Bromwich, 300 Hurricanes, 1,000 Fairy Battles, 600 Stirling and 300 Lancaster Bombers, hundreds of parts for gliders, bow fighters and Miles Masters at Longbridge, thousands of aero engines in Rover and other shadow factories, and tens of thousands of parts elsewhere give just an idea of the effort in the aircraft industry alone. The hangars at Birmingham's Elmden Airport were brought into service for the final assembly of Lancaster bombers, brought here by road and rail from the Austin factory at Coughton Hackett. While back in Longbridge, new and refurbished Hawker Hurricanes were fully completed and winched up on a ramp to Herbert Austin's World War I flying ground, where they were test flown.
And I remember getting upon towards the flying ground, and I could see this thing going round, and as it was going pop, 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 so the balloons were quietly drifting down, you see, and everybody started to let fly. I was by a Bren gun there, and they were banging away for all they were worth. The Oerlikon guns were going like nobody's business. Everybody shouted, "We've hit it," you see, "hit it," because you saw those little bits fall off it. Till after a bit, they stopped twiddling over and started to go in a dive like that. And they weren't bits falling off it, they were bombs, you know. I don't know, it was more surprised us or what, but what amazed me, I can see these bombs come across the field, across the railway line, and into the engineer's shop. But what always amazed me, on the other side of the railway line were some cows in the field, and I thought they were going to go like steeplechasers, but they never batted an eyelid. But you could feel the blast underneath your tin hat.
The day after that one and only raid on the Austin factory, the German Air Force turned the full weight of its attack on the city of Coventry. Throughout the night of November the 14th, 450 bombers battered the city with high explosive and incendiaries till the fires could be seen from Birmingham. As the all clear sounded on the morning of November the 15th, the full horror of Blitzkrieg was plain to see. The cathedral lay in ruins. Hundreds of people were dead, buried in the rubble of their homes and shops, while German newspapers announced that Coventry lay in dust and ashes and that other cities would be Coventried.
There was a circles around each city of brigades, and they were called in gradually, and as one was called in, so the one behind it moved into its place. So we first of all went to Harbin Station to take over there. And then after that, when things got worse, we were sent to the far side of Birmingham to a station there. And then the next trip was straight into Coventry itself. And all around, it just seemed one great inferno. You didn't think that Coventry would be existing at all in the morning. And the bombers were still overhead and bombs were still dropping.
I stood and watched all the planes go over to Coventry the night Coventry was bombed. And there was one or two odd bombs dropped as they were going over. I think that was the night the incendiary dropped in my garden. But the roar of the planes was terrifying as they went over. And then we got guns in the park, which is only were about a quarter of a mile away from me, and when the guns went off, the shelter used to shake.
Birmingham's worst raid followed less than a week later, on the night of the 19th and 20th of November 1940. 350 German bombers came over, they killed some 400 people, they injured more than 1,000. 100 factories were hit, gas and water mains were fractured, which added to the confusion. Here in Armory Road, Small Heath, the BSA's new building suffered a direct hit. BSA factories produced more small arms throughout the war than the rest of the country put together. Rifles, Sten guns, aircraft cannon, rockets and anti-tank weapons. Many of the women workers were quite young and travelled long distances to work. One in particular was kept home that night by her worried father.
He used to stand in the garden and he used to go frantic. He could see the searchlights, you know, see the planes, those that got through the barrage, and he knew that I was there underneath all this. And this one night he had this premonition. He said, "I don't want you to go at all, Duck." He used to call me Duck. I said, "Well, I ought to go. Everyone else is going." He says, "Please don't. Please don't go tonight." He says, "I'll even pay for you to go to the pictures." And, of course, that was a big treat those days, so I didn't go. Anyway, the 7 o'clock news came on the following morning. Mother always used to switch it on, you know, on the old radio, on the sideboard. Came through that BSA had had a direct hit. So called me straight away. I quickly got a bit of breakfast onto the train. And when I got there, the whole place was in ruins where I worked and all my mates. You know, they were saying the names. I realised who they were, and I'd not even been there. I felt awful guilty myself. But it was through my father that I'm here to live to tell the tale today.
53 workers were killed, many of them crushed when machinery fell through ceilings onto people sheltering below. The building was gutted. Firemen tackled over 300 fires in the city.
The water supply was so bad that even the canals into which they'd been taking water from were virtually down to the mud. And it's true to say that had there been a raid the following night, which there was not, no bombs were dropped the following night, then I'm afraid much of Birmingham would have burned. Many firemen were killed, and you know, they were very brave men indeed. When you come to think that 90% of them at the outbreak of war were on train, they were the auxiliary fire service supplementary to the city fire service. And yet those men, they went wherever they were required to go, and they were, as I once heard them described, truly the heroes with dirty faces. They were, there's no two ways about it. They worked long hours. I mean, even after the all clear had gone, they'd still got hours of work, you know, damping down and opening up roads, because it was surprising how quickly, even after raid, things got back to as normal as they could be in wartime.
Between the 8th of August 1940 and the 21st of April 1943, Birmingham suffered a total of 77 enemy air raids. Over 2,000 people were killed, 3,000 seriously injured. 12,000 houses damaged and over 1,000 shops, factories and public buildings destroyed. Yet statistics don't tell the full story, the countless individual tragedies, the death and injury to friends and loved ones, the destruction of homes, the fear and horror of the Blitz.
And then, bang, we heard the bombs come. It was just like a train coming into a station. You could hear them coming, one after the other. And it was a terrible noise. And then, of course, we heard it hit the house. Bang. And the chap that was nearest the door of the Henderson shelter was pulled straight out. And he disappeared. He went straight out with the blast. We'd wonder what had happened to him. And when we sorted him out, he'd gone out with the door. But the Henderson shelter had tipped over on its side. But everybody was all right. And, of course, when we crawled out, the houses were gone. Four houses. It had obliterated them, took them straight out.
We went to the pictures at down Newtown one evening, young lady and I, and when we was told that the warning had been given, and when we came out, we started walking up the streets of my young lady's house, and there's the incendies rolling down off the roofs. And all round, you know, so what we do is walk from one side of the street to the other to avoid them. But we could hear them, because you could hear them hit the roof clock.
So we came up the back garden, he went in to get his coat, I leant against the front door like that, and I could hear this thing coming, but it didn't sound like a bomb. I'd never heard anything like it before. All you could hear was... That was what it sounded like, a train, you know. And I thought, well, that train's in the back garden. And then, of course, everything went up then.
I didn't stop shaking, really, for 2 or 3 days. And after we went back, when the repairs had been done, the first time the sirens went, I couldn't get out of the house quick enough. But apart from that, I wasn't injured at all. We were just filthy dirty and breathing in the gas and the dust. But the people in the house attached to that and the other side were killed outright.
People didn't seem to bring their troubles too much to bear. You know, I'm amazed, really, when I think about it, when I know the number of people who had the houses bombed. Sometimes we had bombing maybe, or there'd be raids, maybe 10 or 12 nights in succession or something like that, and each day you'd hear about someone who'd had the house bombed or damaged or something like that. And they just carried on. It was amazing, really.
A workforce of 15,000 people turned out no fewer than 11,500 Spitfires and 300 Lancasters at the Castle Bromwich Shadow Factory. And by June 1944, they could boast the largest output of any Allied factory, 320 fighters and 20 bombers a month.
A great feeling of urgency, you know, that we've got to get on with it. And if we didn't get on with it, we weren't going to win. And if we weren't going to win, well, that was going to be pretty bad, you know. I think we're all very conscious of that, because we got relations in the forces. We'd lost relations in the forces. She lost her brother. The culmination of the bombing, you know, and the long hours that we had to do, it got serious. And I think 1942 to 43 was about the worst time, I think. That was when it really began to botch, you know.
I used to queue up for about 3 hours for one orange or one banana. And then probably when you're going down home, you might see a house with no children with a dish of fruit in the window, which made you a bit envious, of course. But word used to go round, one woman used to pass it to another, and you'd probably queue for 2 or 3 hours just for one thing, or two tomatoes, something like that.
My brother used to go onto the Welsh border and buy rabbits and come back with a big van load of rabbits. Of course, they had to be skinned then. I didn't skin them, but it was dreadful, really. And then there was a queue half a mile up the road. And of course, you had to try and find out who were your customers that was rationed with you.
Night raids over Britain have lately increased. A few score aircraft coming over by way of reply to the Royal Air Force hundreds that have been blasting Germany. Birmingham has been one of the enemy's targets. Damage was done and lives lost. The same is true of other places in the Midlands and also in the eastern counties. And although Germany's reply to our bombing has not yet been on the 1940-1941 scale, we should certainly allow for the return of the still heavier Blitz. If it doesn't come, nothing is lost. If it does, we shall be ready to beat it again.
Well, I used to travel from Stitchford to Smethwick And if they'd bombed the tram lines, well, then we didn't know what to do. And one day I went out, a bomb had dropped on our tram lines. So I went along Belcher's Lane to Alum Rock, and the bomb had dropped on their tram lines. And there was a number 28 bus coming that went to Coventry Road. So I thought, well, I'll get on that and get a trolley bus on Coventry Road. When we got to Coventry Road, all the shops were blazing and the firemen were standing there with no water to put on them. They'd just got a blaze. And the trolley buses were strewn all over Coventry Road with the wires all down, so I couldn't get on that. So I ran and got back on the 28 bus. And when we got to Camp Hill, the road was so flooded, the bus couldn't go any further than that. So I got off the bus there, walked into town. Oh, and when we got to town, it was in a dreadful mess. There was hose pipes all across the roads, and lots of the big plate glass windows were blown into smithereens all over the place. Terrible job, really, to get. But I got up to Smethwick all right. I always got there somehow, but they never knew what time it would be.
My husband was stationed at Oxford and Biggin Hill. He was in the Air Force. And one day, coming home on leave, he'd hitched a lift from Oxford to Birmingham. And the gentleman that gave him a lift lived at Solihull. So he asked my husband, was he married? Had he got any children? And he said, well, I must call home first. So he called home. He said, I'll take you right to the top of your road. And when he got out of the car, he gave him a parcel. And he said, give that to your wife. And when I opened the parcel, there was half a dozen eggs, a chicken, and some butter in. And we all thought that was wonderful. And that was typical of Birmingham people in the war.
I was going to West Bromwich to the shop, and the murmur went round the bus. I think we've gone over. Did you hear all the planes? I think we've gone over. And all day long everybody was talking, because, I mean, nobody knew anything about it. And then, of course, at night they said that the second front had started, and that was wonderful. That was wonderful.
When V-Day came, the sense of relief, that was the main thing. There was a lot of rejoicing that war had finished and all the rest of it. But the main thing was there was a feeling of relief, not only just in yourself, but you noticed it in other people. It wasn't a case that we've won. It was a case that it was over.
Oh, it was absolutely marvellous. I mean, at that time, my one brother, he'd been reported missing. But just previous to that, we'd had a telegram to say that he was alive and well, that he'd been badly injured, you know. Oh, it was fantastic. Everyone just went berserk.
Reconstruction plans for the battered city called for satellite towns, a green belt, and a halt to the idea of a greater Birmingham. And in an influential film and book, the Bourneville Village Trust hoped that when we build again, we wouldn't be making the same mistakes as before.